Pygmalion by Bernard Shaw.
London, 1912. 11:15 on a wet summer evening. Pedestrians running for shelter into the portico of St. Paul's, Covent Garden. Among them a lady and her daughter in evening dress.
Chilled to the bone, Mother. What can Freddy be doing all this time? He's been gone 20 minutes.
Not so long as that, Clara dear. But he ought to have got us a cab by this.
If he had a bit of gumption, he would have got one at the theatre door. Other people got cabs. Why couldn't he?
Oh, here he is.
You. I'm just about wet through.
Well, haven't you got a cab?
There's not one to be had for love or money.
Oh, Freddy, there must be one. You can't have tried.
It's too tiresome. Do you expect us to go and get one ourselves?
Oh, very well, I'll try again. But I shall simply get soaked for nothing.
Steady, dear. Oh. Do be careful.
Now then, Freddy, look where you're going, dear.
Sorry.
Oh, there's manners for you. Two bunches of violets slod into the mud.
How do you know that my son's name is Freddy, pray?
Oh, he's your son, is he? Well, if you'd done your duty by him as a mother should, he'd know better than to spoil a poor girl's flowers and run away without paying. Will you pay me for them?
Do nothing of the sort, Mother. The idea!
Please allow me, Clara. Oh, dear. Have you any pennies?
No. I've nothing smaller than a sixpence.
Give it to me. Oh. Now, this is for your flowers.
Oh, thank you kindly, lady.
Sixpence thrown away.
Excuse me, can I push in? It's come on worse than ever now.
Oh, dear.
If it's worse, it's a sign it's nearly over. So cheer up, Captain. Buy a flower off a poor girl.
I'm sorry, I haven't any change.
Gown. I'll do buy a flower off me, Captain. I can change half a crown. Take this for tuppence.
Now, don't be troublesome. There's a good girl. I really haven't any change. Oh, stop. Oh, here's 3 halfpence. Is that any use to you?
Thank you, sir.
You be careful, my girl. Give him a flower for it. There's a bloke here behind taking down every blessed word you're saying.
I ain't done nothing wrong by speaking of a gentleman. I've a right to sell flowers if I keep off the curb. I'm a respectable girl, so help me. I never spoke to him except to ask him to buy a flower.
Who's hurting you, you silly girl? What do you take me for?
No, it's all right. He's a gentleman. Look at his boots. She thought you was a copper's knock, sir.
What's a copper's knock?
Why, it's a copper's knock, as you might say. I mean, what else would you call it? A sort of informer.
I'll take my Bible out for them, he said, away!
Oh, shut up. Shut up. Do I look like a policeman?
Then what did you take down my words for? How do I know you took me down right? You just show me what you wrote about me.
All right. There you are.
What's that? That ain't proper writing. I can't read that.
I can. Cheer up, Captain. Now buy a flower off a poor girl.
It's because I called him Captain! I didn't mean no harm! Oh, sir, don't let him lay a charge against me for a word like that!
Charge? I make no charge. Really, sir. If you are a detective, you need not begin protecting me against molestation by young women until I ask you. Anybody could see that the girl meant no harm.
No, he ain't a tech. He's a bloomin' busybody, that's what he is. I tell you, look at his boots.
And how are all your people down at Celsius?
Well, who told you my people come from Celsius?
Never you mind. They did. And how do you come to be up so far east? You were born in Lisson Grove.
Oh, what harm is there in my leaving Lisson Grove? Wasn't fit for a pig to live in. And I had to pay 4 and 6 all week.
Live where you like, but stop that noise.
You take us for dirt under your feet, don't you? Catch you taking liberties with one of your own class. You tell this gentleman here where he comes from if you want to go fortune telling.
Cheltenham, Harrow, Cambridge, and India.
Quite right.
Oh, you're in good company.
May I ask, sir, do you do this for your living in a music hall?
I've thought of that. Perhaps I shall someday.
He's no gentleman. He ain't to interfere with a poor girl.
What on earth can Freddy be doing, Mother? I shall get pneumonia if I stay in this draught much longer.
Earl's Court.
Will you please keep your impertinent remarks to yourself?
Oh, did I say that out loud? I didn't mean to. I beg your pardon. Your mother's Epsom, unmistakably.
Oh, very curious. I was brought up in Large Lady Park near Epsom.
What a devil of a name. Excuse me. You want a cab, do you?
Don't dare speak to me.
Oh, please, please, Clara. We should be so grateful to you, sir, if you found us a cab.
I don't know whether you've noticed it, but the rain stopped about 2 minutes ago.
So it has. It's quite fine now, Clara. We can walk to a motor bus. Come.
With a cab.
How do you do it, if I may ask, this fortune-telling business, I mean?
Simply phonetics. The science of speech. That's my profession, also my hobby. Happy is the man who can make a living by his hobby. You can spot an Irishman or a Yorkshireman by his brogue. I can place any man within 6 miles. I can place him within 2 miles in London, sometimes within two streets.
To be ashamed of himself, a manly cat.
But is there a living in that?
Oh, yes. Quite a fat one. This is an age of upstarts. Men begin in Kentish Town with £80 a year and end up in Park Lane with 100,000. They want to drop Kentish Town, but they give themselves away every time they open their mouths. Now, I can teach them.
Let him mind his own business and leave a poor girl.
Woman, cease this detestable boo-hooing instantly. Or else seek the shelter of some other place of worship.
I've a right to be here if I like, same as you.
A woman who utters such depressing and disgusting sounds has no right to be anywhere, no right to live. Remember that you are a human being with a soul and the divine gift of articulate speech. That your native language is the language of Shakespeare and Milton and the Bible. And don't sit there crooning like a bilious pigeon. Heavens, what a sound. You see, this creature with her curbstone English, the English that will keep her in the gutter to the end of her days. Well, sir, in 3 months I could pass that girl off as a duchess at an ambassador's garden party. I could even get her a place as a lady's maid or a shop assistant, which requires better English. That's the sort of thing I do for commercial millionaires. And on the profits of it, I do genuine scientific work in phonetics and a little as a poet on Miltonic lines.
I am myself a student of Indian dialects.
Are you? Do you know Colonel Pickering, the author of Spoken Sanskrit?
I am Colonel Pickering. Who are you?
Henry Higgins, author of Higgins' Universal Alphabet.
I came from India to meet you.
And I was going to India to meet you.
Well, where do you live?
27A Wimpole Street. Come and see me tomorrow.
But I'm at the Carlton. Come with me now, and let's have a jaw over some supper.
Right you are.
Buy a flower, kind gentleman. I'm short for me lodging.
Liar. You said you had change for half a crown.
You ought to be stuffed with nails, you ought. Here.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.